Hello, everyone, and welcome to another OA Weekly. And I'm joined today again. I didn't have to change this slide, except the date. I'm joined by Horace. How are you doing, Horace?
I'm doing well. Thanks, Charan.
And I think that's Eric in the background. How are you doing, Eric? Uh-oh. He was with us, then we just hear his chair sliding. So hopefully he'll be able to come back and join us. Can you hear us, Eric, while we're waiting for you to come back? Let me say it's been a good week in the markets. And as we begin, I want to remind you that the content in this presentation should not be considered as a recommendation to buy or sell a security. All information is intended for educational purposes only, and an offer should be considered investment advice. Options involve risk and are not suitable for all investors. All rights and obligations of options instruments should be fully understood by you, individual investors, before getting into any trade. Hey, Eric, are you back with us?
Maybe.
Hey, you are here. All right, he lives. All right, so I just did the disclaimer. We could hear some scratching, something happening in the background, but I'm glad you're back with us. So here's what happened this week, right? Dow up about 0.5%, NASDAQ up about 1%, S&P up check, another check quarter. One, yeah, we can hear you, check one, two.
Sorry.
Markets have done amazingly well, given how many issues they have that have come up over the years, over this year. And it feels a little bit like 2013. Markets ended up 30% that year. So about half that for the S&P this year. What are you guys' thoughts about market action this week? Let me start with you, Horace.
It's another impressive week, and I'm getting more and more. I had to do the weekly trade this week, and finding equities I want to enter here is getting increasingly difficult for me. I'm amazed by the resiliency of it, and I just can't buy into the idea that there's another leg coming. But that sure is what it looks like. Eric?
Yeah, I think the path of least resistance is up. There's a ton of news this week that I think just all good stuff. Some corporate earnings that were good and economic reports and, of course, Fed Treasury announcements. Fed Chairman announcements. I just think all of these things are just pointing to the path of no resistance is up. And that's where I think we're going. I just think I'm a little bit like you because I consider myself to be a value investor. And I look at company fundamentals and run models to try and come up with what I think is a fair price for companies. And sometimes I go backwards and say, okay, what does the company need to do in order to justify the price where it's at? And then I just say, well, that's completely unrealistic that the company would do that. So I'm having a hard time like you finding companies that I would buy, but that's fine. I mean, I can trade companies in a stagnant trend as well, but certainly the market is very frothy, except for Apple. I think Apple's still underpriced.
Well, I blame you. I watched your presentation from Dana Point, and so I spent a good portion of the week working through your spreadsheet. And you do that for a day or two, and you don't want to buy anything.
Yeah, you're right, and that's what I'm talking about, man. I'll spend hours going through sometimes looking at different companies and just can't do it. By the way, you weren't the only person. I got at least four other emails from you and four other people email me comments along the same line. So I guess my Dana Point presentation had an impact on some people, which is good. That's why we did it.
Yeah.
I've heard nothing but amazing feedback on that on the summit. So great job, everyone who was there. Great job, Eric.
Yeah, I hate to say this, like every time I say that it's the best, but this, I don't know, this one actually felt like, I mean, you were all there going, man, I don't know whether it was the location or the chemistry or whatever, but this is the best one I've been to for a long time. It was really good.
So Qualcomm, I think, is your trade, Horace, we were talking about just before the show started, and I agree with both of those points. The market keeps going higher, yet if you have new cash, it is very difficult. You know, Qualcomm is a stock Horace and I both had trades on. It's up quite a bit, as you heard today. We'll talk about it maybe a little bit later, but it's harder to find. I mean, look at most technology stocks. Do you find a lot of tech companies right now, anything that has any growth in it with reasonable growth possibility? that is trading at a reasonable amount that you feel comfortable besides Apple?
No, I actually think some of the suppliers, one of my favorites has been Skyworks. That'll be a stock to watch for me because they have earnings coming up early next week. But that's one of the ones that I think is still significantly undervalued. I mean, we're getting the stocks to watch here, but I'll talk about them more towards the end. But it is slim pickings. I think it's slim pickings. But I think you have to go with the themes. And I think, you know, preparing for the show, the theme that is, you know, resonating is, you know, certainly, and I know we're going to talk about it, and that's the tax bill, right? The new tax plan put forth by the GOPs. There are clearly going to be winners and there are going to be losers. And I think that's going to be interesting too, to see who's going to do well based on that. And I think, you know, there's, you know, housing is one of the ones that are supposed, I don't know if we want to jump right to talking about it, but we certainly, you don't mind. Yeah, so you jumped to Lennar, you know where I'm thinking, right?
Well,
so
yeah, some of these stocks are getting hit for no good reason. Because Lennar, if you look at they're not Toll Brothers, okay? Toll Brothers sells the expensive home where this mortgage issue could come into play and it's down more. But some of the other ones are being thrown for no reason.
Right, and I don't know, you know, why they haven't moved sooner or why they haven't moved more. Is it because it's already priced in, or is it because the market doesn't really think the tax plan is going to go through? And I think we saw some surety this week and saw some home builders pull back, but not as bad as I would expect. I mean, Toll Brothers got slammed, but Lennar and D.R. Horton are ones that I watch as well. Those aren't bad, too bad at all. Those, I think there's still some potential value there. So, I mean, there's some of the other themes that are going on there. There's actually, I'll throw it out right now. I wasn't going to say this until later, but there's a new ETF that came out this week, and the tax symbol is, it's Tax R. So it's Tango Alpha X-Ray Romeo, TAXR. It's a brand new ETF that is specifically developed to take advantage of the policy on this new tax plan. It's created specifically for that. And the reason I point this out to people is, you know, if you're looking for ideas on places to trade, and this is, you know, you're going to go off of other people. But what they've done is they've created an ETF based on companies that should do well if this tax plan goes through. And the reason I mention this is, I don't know if people know this, but ETFs are required by law to show how many shares they actually hold in which equity every day. You know, that major companies have to file these 13Fs. So once a quarter, if you manage, is it 100 million or more?
100 million or more,
yeah.
Yep.
Yeah, you got to do a 13F once a quarter to show what, you know, what assets you have and how many shares, and that sort of stuff needs to go in there. But ETFs, dude, they do that every single day. So every day they're required to list what they have. And this TAXR ETF, you can go through there and see who they have. And they're heavily vested in industrial. So 27% is industrial. And then information and technology, consumer discretionary is another 15%. And you can actually go look and see who they have and who they have. They're all sort of, they're reporting most of these ones. I'm looking at the list here. So like Teradata, Ameren, Brown & Brown, Chipotle, Denny's, Quest Diagnostic, Grainger, K-Force, CarMax, PacWest, Phillips 66, United Therapies, Quanta Services, Zions Bank, AK Steel. So some of these companies, Ford Motor Company, I'm looking through some of these I probably wouldn't trade, but other ones, Southwest Airlines on here as well, you know, NiSource. I mean, I go through this list as sort of, okay, let's do some screening on this and see if I see what they're seeing here. But these are companies, they think there's certainly going to be winners and losers. Actually, that was one of the best parts, I think, of the summit, by the way. Greg did a really good job of going through and looking at all this overseas cash. And if this repatriation goes through, who's going to benefit the most? And it's going to have significant impact to some companies. And believe it or not, a lot of the tech companies are on the top of the list. So Apple, Google, the kind of the companies that, you know, wouldn't surprise you, were on there. So I think looking for themes that are going to fit, because that's, I think, what's going to drive the market, you know, going forward here is certainly regulation. And we have a president whose scorecard is what? Its scorecard is look at the stock market, right?
That's absolutely true. Another theme that's been going on is central bank action. Obviously, we had our own Fed news this week with the new chairman coming in and Powell and Janet Yellen leaving. December rate hike looks like a certainty, but also Bank of England lifting rates for the first time in like 10 years. It wasn't quite signaled to go that way. That was a bit of a surprise, but you know, there's some concerns again about Brexit, but none of that really having a much of an impact beyond the currency market. What do you guys think about, is there going to be, from what I've been reading, there's not going to be a whole lot of pragmatic shift in policy in this change in chairmanship. What do you think, Horace?
That's what I've read, certainly. And I guess I'm not surprised that he replaced Yellen, but I don't understand why he would, especially if he's going to replace her with someone who's going to maintain her policies, because now he owns the Fed, right? And what's going to cause our next recession? It's going to be monetary policy. So that is now firmly the Trump administration's problem. So, you know, whereas if he had left her in place, which is traditionally what new presidents do, you can say, well, she's an Obama appointee or whatever, but now he owns this too. And so I understand why he did it, but I think in the end he's going to regret it. But everything I've read, and it hasn't been a lot, is that this isn't a major change in policy. The one I'm reading a book, actually my mother-in-law gave me this, called it's about the 1987 crash, and it talks a lot about Paul Volcker and how Paul Volcker kind of held our economy together as when he was chairman of the Fed, and how important these guys are. And Yellen was, and Bernanke, and
are Greenspan. Are you reading Secrets of the Temple?
No, I'm reading, I can't remember, something about a catastrophe, but it's about the 87 crash. It's actually pretty interesting. I think it's pretty new, and it actually is a lot about the beginning of futures trading. But the point is that this guy is not a trained economist, right? He's a lawyer. So with him and our current Treasury Secretary, I kind of hope we don't have a financial crisis, because I would really like somebody with some grounding in theory if that comes to pass. And I don't know. We'll see. I'm sure Eric has done a full bio of him, though. Right, Eric?
More of the same. I mean, I think he's going to be basically Yellen, and he lines up right under her with regards to votes. So they pretty much fall identically in there. I think, you know, part of his campaign rhetoric, POTUS's rhetoric, was that he was going to get rid of Yellen. And, you know, I think that might be, maybe he felt like he needed to do that. I mean, traditionally they don't, and maybe he didn't need to get rid of her, but it's what he said, and it's relatively painless for him. So you're right. Now he owns a guy on the Fed. I think we're going to get more of the same. I did not expect him to do anything that was going to be hawkish, although there were different names out there. So I felt like he just needed to do something to show that he did something. I mean, I think Yellen was doing an okay job, but it's, you know, I don't think you can use rationality to determine why he does many of the things he does. I mean, it's,
well, look,
nobody knows.
He got what he wanted. Everybody got what they wanted. Here's a lower for longer guy. Here's a guy who's probably going to be a consensus builder within the Fed, because he's not an economist himself, although he brings a lot of other experience. He's been a Fed governor. So I think he's going to probably do everything that Yellen was likely on the path to do. But now Trump gets to say, okay, well, it's not Yellen. So I think it's going to work out. I mean, the market's reaction would have been really adverse had a monetarist or someone been nominated, you know, because that was potentially a possibility. Another theme in this market has been oil, and you know, how oil just continues to move higher week after week. Rig counts down yet again. I think oil rig counts were down 8. You guys think we're headed for $60-$70 oil soon, because of all the economies slightly stepping up and maybe there's a little bit more demand coming in while on the margin supply is being cut? Eric, do you follow oil much?
Yeah. I mean, the news that I heard this week is that OPEC believes that their cuts are going to continue to work. And of course, this week they basically said they're going to extend those all the way through 18.
And so, Russia joined them with that, which is very critical.
Right. So, yeah, so we're seeing oil spike up. It is a new 52-week high. Oil closed on the high today at 55.76. So that's, I mean, it's a new 52-week high that we broke through. So we had a lot of resistance, you know, around the 54, 55 price rate, price level, and now we've broken above it. So there, you know, there could be, you know, an argument that we could run higher there. I tend to be one of these people that believe that there are structural forces in the market that will keep the price low, but we're getting to the place where a lot of companies life starts to get a little bit good right here. And, you know, maybe this will open up. I know one of the sectors that, you know, the construction sector, the services sector, anybody that has had any business tied to the oil industry has really taken it hard. And they've all had to struggle because the refineries aren't spending money. And so getting up here, I think this could be a positive thing for the economy if some of these oil companies, because it does have the trickle down effect that a lot of these other companies start spending money, and then other suppliers are going to, you know, get more sales and new equipment and services, and then that brings more people back to work, get some of those high skilled laborers back to work, and get some wage growth going on as well.
And you know all of that if you live in a oil dependent town like Houston, for example. I got some friends there, and other places in the country too. So I think that has been a pretty good supporter of, you know, it's been an important sector in the market, because XLE and that whole sector, it had been really under pressure all year. I think going into the end of the year, this thing has turned in the summer, late summer, and going into the fall, and looks like it's going to break into new highs. Some of these stocks, one of the ones you mentioned earlier in that fund, and one of the ones that I've been long, and I've owned this for some time, I still own it, is Phillips 66. And, you know, that continues to move higher. There are other names in that sector, like other, you know, Valero, other refiners doing really, really well. All right, those are some of the main themes. Anything else? Did you want to say anything about oil? Do you follow oil, Horace? I'm not sure. I'm still getting to know you a little bit.
I have a bunch of USO that I'm soon hopefully going to be called out of, which would be fine with me. I don't follow oil religiously. It's my thesis in this has been the Aramco IPO and Saudi's need to have oil around $60 a barrel, and that I think that's the number they were citing, and that's a powerful force driving this thing higher. But I did hear a commentator, I think it was actually. I constantly have CNBC on in the background, and sometimes I listen, and I think it was Josh Brown who just said kind of bluntly, oil is coal 10 years ago. You know, there is, in our lifetime, it's very possible that this will not be a major fuel source. And so, you know, that doesn't affect a 3-month option trade, but you wonder where this is going down the road. I think you said that, haven't you, Eric? I mean, isn't that kind of, or am I putting words in your mouth?
No, I believe that, you know, our grandkids one day will be like, you burned oil and drive your cars? What are you, nuts?
This is why Saudis are doing the Iran. They want to diversify national wealth into other assets that are going to last.
You know, that brings to mind also in the tax bill, I believe they have phased out subsidies for electric cars. Somebody should check that, but that is
7,500 a year. The current, that's going to go away in 2018. That's another reason why, I mean, look, Tesla's got some bottleneck issues and production issues with the three, and the stock's starting to come down, although it was up today. Part of that is the subsidy. I mean, I don't know because look, all the traditional American automakers are moving into electric quite a bit as well. It's not just
right. Tesla.
So I think it's not going to pass the way it is.
I didn't think that. I thought that was known, because I thought the phasing out of the electric car credit was known. I'm not pricing it into mine.
It wasn't. It wasn't known to me. How about that? And I don't trade Tesla or electric cars. I just thought it was surprising, given the whole momentum globally towards electric vehicles, to decide we're not going to do that. But whatever.
Well, like a lot of these renewable tax credits, they have to be renewed. Renewing, right. That's redundant. I'm using the same thing. But so, I mean, there's subsidies for solar, there's subsidies for wind. And it's always a big question for developers who are trying to develop out 2 or 3 years and say, you know, am I going to get the tax credit if I build in 2 or 3 years? So it's always was planned to phase out. And I expect that it's going to be a, you know, big impact on, I mean, I think there's some people who think that it's going to be extended, and who knows, Tesla and Elon and Trump aren't buds, so maybe it won't. I don't know.
Yeah, this, you know, this has shown up in solar. You know, the last time the renewal came up was December of 2016. I mean, the stock just took off 2015 at the end. I don't know why this is not loading. Hold on. Because nobody expected that that was going to happen, and then it suddenly happens, and then you know, look at the movement in the stock. So, all right. So with that. Here's something that we've looked at periodically. I only bring it up again because, first of all, this is the 10-year minus the 2-year yield curve, which means, you know, the difference between loaning the U.S. government money for 10 years versus 2. And normally you expect if you pay for 10, if you're loaning money out for 10 years, that you would demand a higher rate of return for it. And so when the, when these two rates become close to each other or even get to the point where the 2-year is yielding more, that's an inverted yield curve. And this is not good for banks. This is not good for, you know, especially the regional banks that don't have as but, you know, big deposits. But another thing this is used for is, as we've talked about many times, is that it, you know, usually comes before a recession. And it again starts to break down here towards the end of the year. I mean, the overall trend, every time we get some hope that it's stabilizing or going higher, it looks like it continues to drop lower. And I'm afraid that as a little bit more Fed tightening happens, there's certainly going to be a hike in December. There's probably going to be at least 2 next year. If the economy actually steps into a higher gear, there might be 3 or 4. Is any of this a concern at the moment for you, for your 2018 kind of outlook, Horace? Or Eric,
I don't know. Yeah, I don't know if the. If, I mean, I'm learning like a lot of people the meaning of this graph. I am concerned about 2018 for a bunch of other reasons, but all the economic data that's coming in has been really strong. I mean, mostly all of it, right? So I don't know what to make of this graph, Eric.
I think, you know, we still got this looks a little worse than it is because in 1 year we're at the lowest point or almost at the lowest point. I think we still have a ways to go if you go a little bit longer term on that. So I'm not as panicked on that as I think we've got a whole nother point to go. But it is important to keep an eye on. We start getting into new territory here, breaking down into new lows. So potential for recession. I mean, it's, you know, if it was simple, it would be, you know, we just put it in a robot and just crank out the cash. So there's multiple forces that are going on in the market. You look at a 10-year chart, we are getting down to, you know, just right before
decade
we
decade long lows.
What is that? That's the 2 year. Oh, that's the 2 year, not the 2 year minus the 10 year.
Okay. No, it's the 10 minus the 2.
Oh, it is the 10 minus the 2, huh?
And it's gone down to 10-year, near 10-year lows. I mean,
yeah, go a little bit.
Looked like it was stabilizing. Yeah. You want me to go longer?
Well, it goes zero before the recession. That's what I wanted to see there. So right before the recession in 2008, we saw the inverted yield curve, and it was nearly 2 years before the recession started. So
exactly. So think about the economic situation in 2005.
Yeah,
we were all pretty happy with what was happening, right?
Right.
That's where we are. But we were headed for a crash.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And yeah, we're going to have another crash, and the market's going to, we're going to have another recession. It's just part of the cycle. It's what happens. The question is when, and then what, you know, what's the market going to do? But I think Horace kind of mentioned, you know, for the next year, it looks like we're going to be, the, you know, economy is going to continue to head, do well, and the stock market's going to continue to up. I mean, that's the way it's looking.
That's the only, you know, there's only so much we can predict about the future, and the farther out you go, the harder it gets. So here's SPX. At 70 RSI again, MACD, you know, the scaredy cat indicator tripped the first, came back up, looks like it's going to turn back around, and the bullish trend remains intact, although overbought on all of these. especially if you look at not just the daily, but also the weekly chart. So Dow Jones Industrial Average continues to make new record highs, and NASDAQ, which has the biggest gains of the year, still not quitting. I think, and I talked about this in the midweek, the last time the market freaked out was because something happened in the Russell or the NASDAQ. I think it's going to come from one of those two sources. It's either going to be a big red candle here, where suddenly there's a bit of a sentiment shift. Apple could have been the cause of that, but Apple did, we'll talk about that later, phenomenally well. I think it's going to be one of these two, the small caps or the NASDAQ. Do either of you, let me start with you, Eric, do you believe that that could be the source of where the next pullback in the market, not a sell-off to a large degree or a crash, but the next buying opportunity, if you will?
What was the question? What's going to be the cause of the next pullback? I missed your...
Like in June and back in July when we had the two pullbacks, yeah, they were driven out of fears of in the growth sector that the market's been putting money in. That's continues to be where all the money has gone, 30% up for the year. So are we looking at, is this a potential place to watch for the next source of a pullback?
Yeah, I don't know where to look for. I mean, it's this, and I was looking, you had a chart of the VIX up there too. It's just, I mean, we're, almost near all-time lows again with the VIX here down, we broke below 9. We were in the 8s today. And that's almost near the all-time low for the VIX. It's just, I don't know what to say. I do think a big part of this, again, I think there's people that are trading, other products and other hedging on the VIX that makes it, that it's probably manipulated. But by the way, while we're on the VIX, I did want to bring up, I read this article recently. I don't have the link here, but there was a big bank that was fined, Wells Fargo. Wells Fargo was fined $3.4 million for their advisors recommending that people trade the VXX. So they had registered investment advisors that were telling people that a good way to hedge their volatility was to use VIX related ETFs. And I just, I am not a big fan. I think my contention is if you really understood the VIX, which you need to understand, and you need to understand the derivatives, you wouldn't trade it because you know that it's manipulated. There's not a question in my mind that it is, and it's not suitable for retail traders. I saw this piece, just here recently, that's a pretty significant fine for people recommending it. And it just amazes me that people still trade things that they don't understand. But yeah, so the VIX, my sense is that the market, we're going to get some big explosion, something's going to happen. And I think it's going to come from something related to robo-trading and hedging of these complex, the rise of robo-trading is it's just incredible. It's really taken off and people feel a lot more comfortable with machines making decisions for them, but they're programmed by humans. And my fear is when the lemmings, they're going to be like lemmings when they head for the door, that everybody's going to head for the door. Everybody's right. Going to sell. And we're just going to get this, the VIX is going to spike up to 25 or 50, something crazy like that. And the market's going to drop, it's going to limit down every day, 3 days in a row, 4 days in a row. People are
going to
freak out.
You ought to look at that book I was talking about.
Well, this is real world.
Which one? The Mandelbrot one?
No. I put the name of it in chat, but now I've forgotten it. It's like a first class catastrophe, and I'm reading it, and it's about the 87 crash and what caused it and how it was kind of the beginning of portfolio insurance, the beginning of program trading, and how all these new technologies in our market structure interrelated, reacted together in a way to create this, and it's exactly what you're talking about. It's 30 years ago, and here we are again.
That's interesting.
It's just, we don't change.
So another data point on the VIX is, Charan, do you remember Rakesh?
Yeah.
So he reached out to
the summit a few times.
Yeah. So he worked for a bank, a local bank in Chicago, and he worked for the trading desk for local bank. And he was telling us that he was using OptionsAnimal strategies there, and he was kicking butt because he was talking about how awesome the adjustments were, and that nobody on the desk understood what he was doing. Well, he told me that he said, I wish I heeded your advice, because he started trading the VIX under his managed accounts. And so he now has a new career. He said that, you know, the VIX finally took me out. He said, I should have listened to you. I think it's like moths to flames, or like, in fact, Floyd, I don't know if Floyd's listening from Alaska, probably not, maybe still at work right now. But he wanted to see a picture that I used for a presentation a while back. And it's like, I think of the sirens, the mermaids that drew, was it from the Odyssey, that tried to get Ulysses to come crash on the rocks because they sang the beautiful songs. And I think that's the VIX and the VIX ETFs, is that they sound beautiful and they're very, very tempting for people to want to trade them. And I just, eventually your ship is going to crash along the rocks and you're going to die.
This is having real world consequences everywhere. This low level of volatility, whether it's driven by robos or whatever. I mean, Wall Street Journal reported that Goldman Sachs revenue from options and other stock derivatives trading strategies down 41% in just the first half of this year, and down 28% globally. Obviously, they're going to be letting people go because, you know, the trades that were working, it says, that were key money-making trades, with the lack of this volatility, with this unusually calm market for such an extended period of time, it's starting to show up in some of the banks' earnings. Well, if you can call Goldman Sachs a bank, but.
So have you seen a chart of the CBOE recently, that stock?
It's amazing, isn't it?
So how did I miss this, right?
No kidding, huh?
So if volume is down,
how
are these guys doing this?
Or some of the brokers.
Yeah.
It used to be an ugly stock. I remember years ago, it was like, it just couldn't get off. I think what's happened is this actually reminds you of the same sort of story of like General Motors. I mean, and this is why you have to have an open mind and be willing to change your mind and go back and reevaluate your thesis. But, you know, you think about, when I think about a decade ago at General Motors, I wouldn't touch it, or 2008, 2009. I mean, it was just, you know, the epitome of what I would think would be a poorly run dinosaur company. And CBOE was that for a while. But they've brought in new management, and I mean, they went through a lot of pain. Of, if you go to the CBOE and look down on the trading floor, it's scary because it's like a ghost town down there. There's all these pits and there's nobody there. And so they've had to really transform their business. But I think this is an example of a company that realized, hey, we got to change our business model, and the market's changing and we're going to respond to it. And I think they've done a good job. I think, did you pull up a chart of the CBOE? No, it's amazing chart. It is unbelievable.
Is it CBO?
You got it. You're going to say, wow, when this refreshes. I know you will. Look at that chart. That's just crazy, isn't it?
Here's another one.
Who's that?
E-Trade.
E-Trade. Wow. Wow. Nice.
Yeah. Even though there's not been a lot of volatility, brokers have somehow managed to do quite well. So I think there's been, you know, the consolidation obviously has helped. All right, moving on to earnings. For me this week, Mondelez, I was watching that one, Under Armour. Under Armour was amazingly bad, and it's going to get worse, I think. I'm in a neutral caller. And then Wednesday, Qualcomm. Qualcomm has had a phenomenal volatility for – I don't think I've ever seen it move this way as long as I've kept an eye on it. Just massive moves up and down. Earnings, other news, lawsuits, now a takeout, potential takeout bid by Broadcom. And then SunPower and First Solar, you know, so SunPower's in the solar industry. Apple, obviously, on Thursday, Berkshire Hathaway just now. For me, Under Armour is the one stock that I have that I'm concerned about how long it's going to take for them to right the ship. So let me just show you this chart. So just the opposite chart of what we've seen before. So my cost base is near 13 and change. The stock is down at 1162, continues to fall. I think it's going to get into the single digits. I'm glad I don't have a massive position, is all I can say, because this company is going to take a while to kind of right itself most likely, and it certainly could get down to $7-$8, I think. Okay, what are you guys watching, Eric? I'm sure you had earnings that you were watching this week that you want to highlight.
Well, you know, there's this fruit company that released earnings this week that was kind of okay. Apple just absolutely crushed it. I mean, tore the cover off the ball. What was the anecdote you were sharing, Horace? With
they sell six phones per second. That's one of them. Six phones per second, and their profit this quarter was greater than Facebook's revenue. So I think isn't Facebook like the fourth largest company in the world, or something? You know, from market cap point of view, it's ridiculous. Every time you look at Apple's numbers, you get just things that don't make sense to you. It's kind of, yeah.
It's just so huge. It's just unbelievable, right? And I mean, I was looking at their balance sheet. The cash is just, you know, off the charts, right? Was it 200 and something?
38
billion dollars in cash.
I think year over year.
They could buy New Zealand and have money left over, I think was an anecdote that I saw. It's just absolutely crazy. I contend that the most important thing to Apple is delivering shareholder value. They, you know, people can talk about the products, and I think that for them is a vehicle. I believe, and this is doing a completely objective, hardcore look at the fundamentals. If you look at their performance, I like to graph the change in owner earnings. I have never, ever seen a chart as good as Apple. And I need to update it to get the data. And I have everything, but I need to dig into the financials because I'm still looking at the capital number that I need to put in. But hopefully this weekend I'll update my model to come up with a new forecast for where I think Apple's going to be. My last one, I think, was 178 or 170 something was the last forecast that I'm looking at. But they continued to, keep saying, okay, well, they did it last quarter. They have had a down revenue. Like last year, we had a down quarter. But I think the company does what it needs to do. And every quarter, they do better and better. You say, okay, well, they can't keep doing this. And I think that's what I hear that argument from people. The company, they can't keep doing this. Well, the market capitalization of Apple right now is $900 billion. I mean, we're almost talking a trillion. It'll be the first. I mean, it's the most valuable company in the world ever. And probably will hit $1 trillion. I have no doubt that it will hit. That's arbitrary. It doesn't mean anything. But the company really sincerely cares about delivering shareholder value. And they do that by delivering awesome products and commitment. Just an amazing company. And I say that, I mean, I am an Apple fan, and I did pre-order the Apple 10. I did do it, you know, in the morning, early in the morning. So I don't know when I'm going to get mine. But I do separate my emotions from the fact that I love Apple to it's a trading vehicle. I am concerned. I would prefer that it had more room to go. I prefer that it was 30% less than its intrinsic value. But I'm okay trading it here using, you know, stagnant to bullish trades. That's what I'm in. And it was a good week for Eric, by the way. So I'm happy.
All right. Horace, how about you? That's a good takeaway, by the way, you know, separating your emotions from what you like about the product or the company. Horace, yeah, how about you? What earnings were you watching this week?
I had a lot of earnings this weekend. So I had Apple. I have a fairly sizable position in Apple, so I was happy with that. And I a couple other stocks I followed. There's an Apple supplier called Cirrus Logic. It's CRUS, and they report, traditionally they report 20 minutes before Apple does. And if you're looking for, I have to do more work on this, and I sent some notes to Eric, and these guys trade with a PE of about 13. They make the sound chips. And if you want a stock that is, so they are more levered to Apple than Apple is to the iPhone. In other words, 79% of their revenue stream comes from Apple. Another 15% comes from Samsung. So that's a greater percentage than Apple's revenue in iPhone. And they had decent earnings, but they went right up to, I think, the 200-day and bounced right back. So I'm still watching this. I own some of it. So I'm going to do more work on this because I don't know why their PE is so low. That was one.
Is there fear that Apple is going to pressure suppliers more?
If you want a good example of the risk section of a filing, go read Cirrus Logics, because they basically say if Apple wanted us to go away, we would go away. You know, they have no leverage, right? They're a small company, but they've been working with Apple for years and years. So I don't know, but I think that must be part of it. The other part of it is it's a chip stock, and as Eric was saying, these are commodities basically. So if you look at a really long term chart of Cirrus Logic, it does kind of have a very long cycle. It goes up, goes down, and recently it's been going more up, but it is a rather cyclical commodity type stock. So anyway, I'll do more work on that. And then I had Activision Blizzard, which I actually put a weekly trade on today. They're the makers of Call of Duty. They had a great quarter, or they had a good quarter. The problem with their quarter was they had a really tough comparison to last year, from what I can understand. But they beat their own guidance. They raised guidance going forward. It's a cash machine. But this is a company that's gotten expensive. Back in 2013, their PE was around $12, and now it's up around 40. So it's not like it's a bargain up here. And it's a pretty interesting candle today, I think. So we'll see what happens with that. And then what else? I mean, Starbucks was this week. You mentioned Under Armour, and there were a couple others I thought too. But yeah, it was a busy week in earnings for me.
Qualcomm, I just wanted to talk about. I just wanted to show you that chart because, if you look around the tech space, especially in the larger cap names, there are very few bargains. I think you guys will probably agree with that. There are some smaller companies in the Russell 2000 that may be still attractive, but Qualcomm was one that got attractive because of what happened with it and Apple at the beginning of the year and other lawsuits and, FTC looking into. So this stock went through an unusual amount. Nobody could have predicted this would have happened this week.
Wow.
And so, I was in a covered call. I didn't want to be in the covered call for the earnings. I wanted to be in a bull put. So I closed my covered call, got into a bull put. Then that happened. On news, and then it rebounds on earnings, and then today Broadcom says, well, there's a report out, not confirmed last I checked, that Broadcom's going to buy them. Seems like a great fit. They don't have a lot of overlap in their Venn diagrams of the kind of products and stuff they do, and Qualcomm is now, the offer is going to be near $70, and it traded about 65. I don't know, this is probably going to have a lot of regulatory issues, but one of the immediate outcomes was Qualcomm has a bid out for National or NXP Semiconductors, and that stock took a massive hit intraday today. So they were supposed to get bought out at 110. The offer just keeps getting extended. It looks like it's going to go into 2018, and now it's all up in the air if Broadcom's going to buy Qualcomm. So a lot of volatility happened in some of these names in the chip space. And also Intel didn't have earnings or anything, but it has moved up so much so quickly. And the nice red candle we saw today, I think, could be an interesting bearish trade short term. All right, next. Economic events. So to me, personal income rising 0.4% versus a consensus of 0.3. Briefing.com got that one right. That stood out, right? The PCE pricing without the core, just the 0.4% increase, that stood out as well. These are all things that, again, I'm concerned that one of the things besides either the legislative process or the central banks under new leadership, too aggressive, one of the sources for where the next problem comes is inflation. And recently, just in the last few weeks, I guess it started with China PPI numbers coming in a little hot. If income, if PCE prices, if we start to see some pressure, that could be one of the things that dampens the sentiment in the market in 2018. We'll have to keep an eye on that. Outside of all the traditional things like jobs, of course, we're going to talk about, that really stood out to me. But on the other hand, then on today, the average hourly earnings came in flat. So we'll have to see, you know, these numbers kind of rise in step for some period of time before that thesis becomes more valid. All right, Horace, what stood out to you in economic news this week?
Yeah, one of the numbers that stood out was that average hourly earnings flat with 4.1% unemployment. So I'm not an economist, but
conundrum.
I don't understand this. And then, you know, the Chicago PMI was strong, ISM services was strong. It kind of more of the same. And I don't follow the automakers, but I believe there were some pretty good auto sales this week too. So it just continues to look like an economy that's kind of humming along. And where's the inflation? So,
well, some of it might be, you know, I was listening somewhere today that, you know, there's a lot of growth in productivity, for example, in retail, but it's fewer people. You know, mm-hmm. like three people lose their job in the mall and Amazon gets one in the warehouse. So there's this churn happening in a lot of different parts of our economy because of technological improvements that may be at the root cause. It may be also some demographics, I'm not sure. But what about you, Eric? What stood out to you this weekend?
Well, I think the biggest thing to me is wage growth. And that's, you know, I know that's what you guys are talking about here. It's dumbfounds me that we're seeing the markets at, you know, all time highs. We're seeing consumer sentiment just, you know, spiking and volatility very low. And it's just consumers aren't actually seeing it. And there's no inflation, right? So then people are not getting more money in their paychecks, other than the, you know, the normal raise, annual 2% raise or something like that. It's just, I knock myself in the head wondering what the heck's going on here. Why are we not seeing it? Because one of the other things that jumped out in the payroll report was the reduction of the workforce, and that 724,000 people left the workforce, and that's got to have pressure too. I mean, our unemployment just went down to 4.1%. I contend that we can get as low. I think in my head, I envision a 3.7 as being full employment. I think we can get down lower. It's a little bit harder to get there. Every last little increment, you got to fight a little bit harder for to get down there. But I just don't understand why we're not seeing the wage growth. And maybe a lot of it has to do with housing, because that's a big part of it, that the housing market is still fighting. And maybe we need to see, I think we need that inflation is what we really need to see in order to get it going. Maybe the oil going up too could help too, because, you know, all these people that are out of work now, and who, I don't know, maybe that's not going to have wage. Maybe they'll be happy to come back to work. I don't know why we're not seeing it. It has been buyer's market.
This is only recently that we've been down in this range, and especially at this level of range and with the claims where they are. And it takes a little bit of time sometimes for inflation. Once it kicks in, though, it can catch everyone by surprise. It's a little speedboat. It's not a big destroyer. So that's something to remember about inflation. Last thing to me that stood out here was crude inventories down. You know, again, I think it's amazing that with the dollar rising, crude is rising too. It's happening in lockstep. I don't know what to make of it. I think that the trend is not going to last forever. But, you know, like we get next week, maybe some rig count that start to come online with oil now in the mid 50s, Brent 60s. That could bring some of that back in balance, but boy, that has been something to watch. All right, for next week, we have a much smaller set coming out. Jolts is going to be important. That's important because when you hear that the Fed is data dependent, there was an article I actually printed out the list from it. There's 30 things that the Fed is, you know, mainly looking at. That includes a lot of stuff. And one of those things is job openings, which have been at historic highs. So I'll be looking to see what happens there. Crude inventories. Anything happening here or internationally, Horace, that you'll be watching? Or is it mostly going to be the continuation of earnings?
Yeah, for me, it's going to be the continuation of earnings. Not that I have a lot, but there's still a lot of large companies to report. The other stock this week that reported right was Facebook. That's the one that skipped my mind, which was another colossal report. So, Didn't they report?
Yeah, something like a 80% rise in profit from a year ago. The
79%
stock,
in revenue. It's just unreal. And then, you know, he talked it down because he said, you know, they're going to spend so much money on security that they're going to meaningfully impact their earnings. But this one, this is another stock I have positions in and we'll be looking forward to next week. But no, there's not a lot of economic news next week. I mean, there's more of this tax reform stuff that's going to unfold. So who knows, maybe that'll finally begin to impact our market.
Yeah, we'll see how easy it is to get that done, given the experience that we had with the last major effort in the House, and especially in the Senate. Now that there are more open rebellion senators in the last few weeks. Okay, well, with that, I think the only announcement we have, I don't know, I haven't seen if there's been a workshop scheduled yet. It's early in the month of November, so that's going to be happening soon. But we have a Las Vegas one-day summit happening on the 17th of November. Eric, you going to this one?
I am not. I thought I was going to, but I am not.
Okay.
So I think it's going to be Casey and Greg.
Okay. All right. Stocks to watch. Who wants to go first?
Go ahead, Eric. Have at it.
I can okay. go first if you want to.
No. So NVIDIA is one that I'm watching. Yeah, they have a report coming up. I'm not trading NVIDIA. It's interesting. I did hear a thesis that the reason NVIDIA is going up is people are using it to mine Bitcoins and that it's the proxy for Bitcoins, and that explains its rise, which is interesting. NVIDIA has been on my watch list probably as long as anything else. And so it's got earnings next week. So I plan to keep an eye on it. So the stock symbol is November Victor Delta Alpha. Another one that's got earnings next week that is what I think is one of the few values that are still out there, and that is Skyworks, and that's Sierra Whiskey Kilo Sierra, SWKS, S-Works. Skyworks, they are an Internet of Things company, and they provide products to just about everybody that makes anything electronic, including Apple, but they're diversified. They're in, you know, the Echo and, you know, the Alexa device. They're in tons of stuff, and they have earnings on Monday after the close. So I think a really well-run company. I do like them a lot. I have done trades on them before. One thing that's not so good is the option liquidity. The bid-ask spreads are pretty wide. So it's difficult if you're going to have to make an – if you do one trade, it works for you. You hit your primary exit, not so bad. If you have to make a lot of adjustments. But I'm hoping that it gets better. Maybe me talking about it get more people trading it, and then the option liquidity will get better. I don't know. The other one that I need to go through is Berkshire Hathaway. So Bravo, Romeo, Kilo – dot alpha or dot bravo, depending on how you want to look at it. And they did release earnings today, which I haven't had a chance to digest, but I do want to go through and look and see what they had to say. I understand earnings were down, and they're attributing it to the hurricanes, because a big portion of their business is insurance, so they would logically be impacted by that. But other companies seem to have done well in the face of earnings, like the jobs. I would have expected the economic report for jobs would have been bad, but apparently not. But I want to tear through that and just see if I can pick up any nuggets. I'm not going to trade Berkshire Hathaway, but I am going to look at it. So unfortunately, the only one of the two that I mentioned would be Skyworks, and Skyworks is the only one that I'm probably bullish. NVIDIA is more for information, and Berkshire Hathaway. So not as many trading ideas as I have, but I have. I will be looking to play some new trades, because I had a bunch of short calls in the money on Apple, and they were weeklies this week, and I opted not to roll them before earnings, and I couldn't roll them after earnings because it was basically nothing. So I'm going to have a bunch of capital freed up, and I'll be doing some new trades next week. That's it for me.
All right. Let me put that in here. All right. What was your last one? Second one? NVIDIA, Berkshire.
Skyworks. And you can throw Apple on there, too.
Yes.
Yeah, I'll probably do another trade on Apple next week so I get back into it. I'll probably do that. Bullish. Bull put or something. maybe a diagonal or broken wing butterfly or something.
Okay, thank you for that. How about you, Horace? What's your?
So I'm going to be watching. These are stocks that. Well, first one is Adobe. ADBE, and this is breaking out again. So I have a position in Adobe, and I'm going to be keeping an eye on it because this is one of those stocks I wonder how high it can go. But the Bollinger Bands are opening. It consolidated after a strong earnings event, or a strong they raised their guidance, popped up, and here it goes. It's continuing. A new stock for me that I'm going to take a look at next week is PayPal. I have a small position in this, and I want to keep looking at it. They had earnings recently, did really well, and I think this might be something relatively well valued, although I haven't taken a long, hard look on it yet. And let's see, what else can we? American Airlines. Jeff's not here, so this. I got out of America. I got called out of American Airlines, and it's been dropping fairly steadily. Looks like it has 3 or 4 days of consolidation going on, maybe at this level. So I'd be looking for this to turn up, and I've been doing bull puts, taking the stock if I have to, seeing if this can just continue in this range, in a slightly biased. That, and then of course I'll be keeping an eye on Activision. My thesis with Activision is that the range that's extended since August is going to continue. They have a major game released today. I don't play video games, but I know people who do, and so I think that'll keep it supported. It bounced really well right off the 100-day today, but it's expensive. So I'm hoping this stays range-bound. That's it for me.
All right. Thank you for that. Let me put the Activision in here as well. All right. My first one to watch is Akamai, which this stock has already had earnings out of the way. It popped on earnings quite a bit. It's being held down, kind of like Qualcomm in a way. You know, there's this one binary thing that, or one major concern that people have for Akamai. It's that some of the, their big customers are gonna want to do what Akamai does for them, content delivery or security or other things. They want to do it in house and not pay them. So like, why would Netflix use Akamai services? So this is a stock that is a dominant player in its industry that got knocked down a little too much. And I think it's probably going to stay stagnant to bullish. I'm doing bull puts and covered calls in this name. I wish it had a dividend, but most technology companies don't. So earnings out of the way, and it's come back down nicely and rising from recent support, the gap up place. I think this one becomes a tradable opportunity here. That's Alpha Kilo, Alpha May. My second one is similarly another stock, Schlumberger, best in class in its space in the oil services sector. Now, again, this is highly levered play to oil. So like when oil goes down, oil services stocks go down a lot. They're not like refiners like Valero or Phillips 66 or an integrated oil like ExxonMobil, where they're not going to be as levered to the price of oil. But Schlumberger has come in, put in about a double bottom. I think it looks attractive if you believe in the thesis that at least till 2018, this Aramco thing, that oil is going to be supported. Now it has come back down. I'm hoping it's making a higher low here, but I'm not sure. So next week that'll play out. We'll know a little bit more. But I think this one, given the fact that it also pays, I think, a 50-cent dividend for a $63 stock that has been coming down all year. Look, money rotates, and this could be caught up in the oil sector rotation that is currently taking place, as we see in the XLE. Let me put that in before I forget which ones I had. And the last one is Foot Locker. Foot Locker is one of the stocks that is down so much so quickly that I believe it has become a value. They got a lot of cash, think about $1 billion in cash. They cannot be driven out of business because they're not highly leveraged into debt. And the stock's been thrown away and is, you know, I think pricing in that the earnings will be going down every year, 5-6% every year. If you think the earnings will be flat, the stock would be higher. If you think earnings will go 3-4%, the stock would be much higher. But that's not the sentiment around this stock at the moment. There may also be mutual fund dumping of the stock ahead of the end of the year for window dressing. We'll find out. But I think fundamentally, this is now a company that does quite well in its space. It's one of the larger players compared to like a Big Five or Hibs or others. The main challenge here in their bullish thesis is no one knows for sure whether this, you know, they sell basically shoes, mostly Nike shoes. So the bump in Adidas is not really helping them out as much as you would think. And people are just not shelling out the $150 for a sneaker as they have been in the past. So is it a cultural shift that Nike's reign in basketball shoes and the era of, and you know, celebrity endorsements driving shoe sales, and is that over? Nobody knows for sure, but the stock is certainly being priced in for such an outcome. Obviously, direct-to-consumer efforts by Under Armour, Nike, the selling on Amazon. You know, what I think is happening here is that some part of the shoe business is going to get commoditized and some of those weaker players are going to go away, but Foot Locker is not one of them. So the, you know, the lower priced Nike shoes that can sell at a Nordstrom's Rack, fine. You know, maybe that business gets threatened. But, and even if it is that in 10 or 15 years, this business is dying, I think the stock is going to catch some nice bounces along the way. So that one is my value play. You can email me actually, Eric. I'd like to hear your thoughts on what you think is the real value in Foot Locker and see if I'm right there. Okay, final thoughts. Hey, look at that. We're almost on time. Horace.
No, have a great weekend. Thanks. It's always a blast being with you guys, and I hope you all have a good weekend.
And Eric.
Yeah, I just want to move the microphone back over in front of my face. I just wanted to tell people to, you know, the reason why we have a process is to really try to control your emotions. I think trading from the gut doesn't have any place in making financial decisions. Maybe it does in hobbies or other places, but if you want to be serious and make money, you'll be rational and, you know, follow the Options Animal 6-step process. And I believe you will not be successful if you don't pay close attention to step 4, and that is defining your primary and secondary exits. That if you want to be successful, you will do the work and you will plan your trades. That's it for me.
Thank you. Thank you both a lot. I got to second that. Look, I've had some trades here recently. Qualcomm's volatility. If you don't have a secondary exit, you are going to be getting chicken out of trades that are going to eventually work out. So thank you again for everyone being here. Thank you, my co-panelists, Eric and Horace. We'll see you guys next week at the same time. Bye-bye.